Welcome back to the Checkpoint with me, Vivian Kamsime. I am hosting Major Retired David Rusa, who is a security expert and former director of operations at Internal Security Organization. We are talking the Kasese situation and what happened over the last week. But I would like to ask you, just before we went for the short break, we were talking about how the ADF was formed and the operations at the time when they actually started these attacks. Why do you think that they camped in Kasese and neighboring districts and not any other areas?
Okay, I mean, it's all a question of proximity. I've told you their main base is in DRC. And of course, the area, the Kasese area, is close next to DRC, and then the terrain of Kasese, it is mountainous, so it's easy for them. I remember when we had to fight them up in the mountains, the late General Kazini and his team had to climb up in the mountains where it was extremely cold, and as a result of that, that's when we formed the Mountain Brigade. These people had were so high in the mountains, and it was not easy to get to them. But somehow, through the efforts of our the UPDF, we managed to get them and even flush them out. And that was no mean achievement. It was a great achievement to flush them out. Because once people take those positions in the mountains, those are vantage positions. And it is from those angles, it's not easy. They would have commanded that whole area if it was not for the efforts of our troops then. Okay? Yeah. And so after we had flushed, but like I told you, these people came to Kampala between 1998, 99, 2000. There were so many bombings in the city. People had even stopped going to social places. And again, our intelligence operatives, together with the police, and of course the UPDF, equally managed to flush these people out of the city, which was not easy. You were not sure traveling by bus. So many buses were blown with grenades. I know of a friend's wife who lost legs through a grenade attack. That time there was so much vigilance and our people came together. You would have to have all luggage checked. You had to have checks in the bonnet, in the boots, everywhere. It was a rough situation. It was. And what made matters worse, there was also the Kony insurgency. So you can imagine there was ADF in the west, and Kampala, and then in the north, there was Kony.
There's also the HIV insurgency, all sorts, the disease that was really killing people.
Of course, but HIV was there right from the time our government came into power.
And that's one of the threats that this government also faced besides these wars.
And then, of course, there have been a number of many other threats. Mm. But what distinguishes ADF from these other threats is that it is a religious, at least they claim to be fighting for a religious cause. So they are Islamists, they are Islamic fundamentalists. They are not secularists. They are not fighting for democracy. They are not fighting for equal rights. They are not fighting for human rights. They are fighting to install a religious government, if you will. Something which is, of course, which is ridiculous. And especially in a country, our country is secular. And that's what makes us strong. Because you have all religions here. Everybody is free to practice.
To practice the religion.
Nobody is hindered or hampered. And so one would wonder why somebody wants to come and impose one religion on everybody.
That's a puzzle, actually. But the UPDF launched Operation Shuja.
Yes.
And this Operation Shuja was to wipe out the enemy at source. Now we see the ADF continuing to attack people. Is that the operation is not effective? Is it that the ADF are gaining strength? Or that there is weakness on the side of the forces?
Well, if ADF was gaining strength, they would be attacking military units. But as far as I know, ADF has not attacked a single UPDF unit since they were since the beginning of Operation Shuja. They have been attacking what we call soft targets, unarmed, innocent people, civilians in Congo, people in gardens, people out grazing their cattle, traders, and now they have attacked. This is sad. It's very sad. All of us who are human beings cannot fail to be moved by what we saw. Kids, these young people, you are hacking them to pieces. And those beasts were even filming and laughing.
Very sad.
It's a very sad situation. I'm a Christian, and I know our Lord Jesus forbade us from revenge. He said revenge will be his. But as human beings, we cannot fail to see and feel angry, feel bitter. That young boy who survived, I had his interview last night, and he was saying he wants to join the forces so that he can avenge his dead colleagues. You know, you can imagine such a young boy who survived by smearing his lips, his nose, his ears, his face with the blood of his dead comrades. That's how he survived.
Very painful story.
You cannot imagine this.
But talking about that school situation, there have been two theories. The first theory is that there was a school ownership disagreement on ownership, or that there was actually the ADF terror that we are talking about. Which one is more believable when it comes to what could have happened at the school?
Well, whether there were wrangles or not, ADF was used. They might have been bought. Of course, sometimes they act as mercenaries, I'm told. Sometimes they are paid to settle scores. Perhaps in the case of the school, I don't know. I have no intelligence, I have no information. But even the first lady talked about it. She was also saying she had heard that there might have been wrangles. Well, even if there were wrangles, still that does not exonerate ADF. ADF must have been the people who executed those kids. And so the first time they are doing it. Remember in 1998, Kichwamba Technical Institute then, which is actually near Fort Portal, where I think they killed also tens of children. So many were killed, maybe 90. Others were abducted. Some have never even returned. So, killing of children by ADF is not a new thing. Or even killing innocent people. And then, of course, this ideology of hate is not unique to ADF. All these extremists, Look at Boko Haram in Nigeria. Boko Haram means Western education is forbidden, and mainly for girls.
Yes.
They abduct, they kill.
The most famous one being the Chibok girls.
Chibok girls, yes. You remember? Then look at Al-Shabaab. They equally do the same.
Now, talking about the Al-Shabaab, after the Al-Shabaab attacked her at Miss Bess in Somalia, you will remember a few weeks ago, and now we are seeing this attack from the ADF. Some security experts have been saying that there is an intelligence gap within our forces. How true is this, or false? Is it false anyway?
Well, the Al-Shabaab attack, I don't have the facts, but they attacked our unit in southern Somalia, and the president talked about it at length. And I believe all that he talked about, because he even had some strong words for some of the commanders, for some of those lapses and gaps you are talking about. He talked about it. There was general lack of vigilance, I think. You see, what made NRA a great force, or UPDF, is that permanent vigilance. Permanent vigilance, permanent suspicion, permanent movement. Those are the things which made NRA and UPDF after it a formidable force. You were always suspicious of that the enemy can surprise you. And you were always on movement. Even if you were not moving camps, you would still be around monitoring, surveillance. And of course, vigilance. Anything suspicious. Now, maybe after a long time, you know, that's what happens, bureaucracy. When institutions, after a long time, they become bureaucratic. And even the military becomes bureaucratic. So that people lose that vigilance. If you know the vigilance we had, 1986, 1987, up to, you know, we defeated these people when our forces were still, they were not mechanized. They were using the old methods, but we managed hold of enemies. Until now, we have built a very strong force, which is all over the region keeping peace. But we need to realize that that element of vigilance
when you're
is not
about
as it
that
was.
Element
then.
Of vigilance, are you talking about civilian intelligence? Because in this particular case, one of the commanders actually said that these people had camped in the area for about 2 days. And he was saying, why didn't they report this to the security
that
agencies?
That is true.
So the people could have been the ones maybe to tell the security agencies that there are some unknown people who are in our areas and we don't know what they're doing, or we are suspicious of them. Is that the kind of
thing that is very
you're
true.
Talking about?
You see, the whole idea of what are called LCs now, initially they were called RCs, Resistance Committees and Councils. The idea of forming resistance committees, it started in the Luero Triangle during the war. And they were like the watchdogs, the ears and eyes of the struggle. They would detect wrong people and inform the militants to go and fight them. But, so even when we transplanted the RCs, then, that was the idea. RCs were very vigilant, and they were not earning any money. And they were fighting all crimes, by the way. There was very low crime level in Uganda during the time when the RCs were active. That 10-year period between 1986 and 1996. In fact, Uganda was a role model of almost of everything that was good in this region. Then after that, And I think, to me, I tend to think the reintroduction of elective politics, especially multi-party, has done a lot to derail the achievement that we had attained that time.
But you can't say that, because that is freedom of speech, that's democracy. And if you're talking about attainment of achievements, definitely achieving democracy should be one thing that you should be proud of.
Yeah, sure. Yes, that's why we... By the way, that time we had what was called a no-party democracy. And I think it might even have been more democratic. Why? There was no manipulation that time. People were being voted for on individual merit. Somebody stands, they say, Vivian, she's iron-handed, she's rude, we are not giving her her vote. Today, the moment they talk like that, Vivian will go and bring cash. And you, all of a sudden, she will turn into a very polite person.
Well, that's not Vivian.
Well, I'm using you as an example.
Yes.
Or you talk about me.
Yes.
Say, David Rusa is a rude man, he's bad. But the moment I bring money, all of a sudden I get washed. And that is what has happened. Politics of manipulation, intrigue, all things which the NRA was fighting. In fact, if you look at what we used to call revolutionary methods of work and subversive tendencies, many of the things that we had categorized as subversive then are the things we see around now. Well, freedom, democracy, yes, but then the revolution, in a way, has lost its that... ingredient,
if you like,
which we cherished.
Well, talking about that, share with us some proposals that you think the local leaders, our force, and even governments can actually do, or interventions, how best they can actually eliminate this ADF at this point.
Of course, ADF cannot be fought by the army alone. You know, the ADF question is really a matter for the community, popular vigilance, which I talked about. Everybody, they say everybody should be his brother's keeper or his sister's keeper or her sister's keeper. Everybody should be on the lookout. You know, the Banyarwanda one time were saying, Banyarwanda, mube maso, meaning be eyes, watch out. You see, mukuwe macho. See, if somebody comes to your area, like the, if it's true that these people spent 3 days or two, how could such a number of people come to an area? And an area which is not, where there's a lot of suspicion, of course, because this is an area, it's not only ADF, there are also this M23. So how could people in such, but M23 doesn't operate there. It operates south, around Kisoro, and maybe Bunagana. Rather, Kisoro, Bunagana, perhaps Togota, those areas of Rukunjeri, not north. North, really, it's ADF and Mai Mai. So, if it's true, these people came. But anyway, another thing, what if they also have their own morals or supporters? It is possible, and I believe there could be their own supporters.
In fact, talking about that, one of the local leaders talked about that when he said that the ADF has locals that feeds them with food and information. So you are rightly saying that there could be people within the community that are actually their supporters in that sense.
I'll tell you, I saw families which would move to Congo, man, husband, wife, and small kids, cross to Congo, especially on market days. There's a market there called Kasindi. People would go as if they are going to the market, when in reality they were going to join ADF. We arrested some of them that time, around 92. We even had movies. And, well, of course, when I left office, I couldn't move with government property. I don't want to be treated like Trump. But but families, if you see the pictures of these people, the training, there are women there. There are small kids, of course. They are the majority, I think, and men. So even, I'm sure, in Impondwe and those other surrounding areas, they have their own informants. They must have. You cannot go to an area where you do not have supporters and then carry out successful operation and even disappear. So I believe they have their own supporters. Of course, terrorist groups have what they call cells, terrorist cells. Some of these extremist groups, these Islamist groups, some of the recruitments were done in what are called madrasa schools. Well, madrasa schools, the equivalent, I think, in the Christian would be like catechism classes. These madrasas were supposed to teach religion. But instead of teaching religion, they have been teaching hate. Some of them, they have been teaching jihad, teaching, and even when you hear some of these people talking, they refer to anybody who doesn't believe like them as kafir.
Okay, so it means that the community must be they on
definitely,
top of their game
definitely
for this ADF
they have,
to be dealt with. I just want to ask you one last question. There's a time when government was engaging the ADF in dialogue. In fact, that was 2008. And some of these combatants agreed to amnesty with our government. Don't you think that it's high time? Or why couldn't these efforts be resumed?
Well, I believe our government is one of the unusual ones which even negotiates with terrorists. Even the United States, they don't talk terrorists. But we had said, okay, let's discuss with them. And I'm sure even now there's an amnesty commission, presidential amnesty commission. I'm sure the door is still open to forgive whoever renounces or denounces rebellion and said to come back and be a good person. But of course, I think those who committed atrocities, they are answerable. Unless, well, it will depend. I think we try to distinguish between the leaders and the led. If one was just led and was not notorious, was not involved in excessive crimes, that person can be forgiven. But going back to what we're saying, to fight terrorism needs a lot of vigilance. And we have another enemy in our midst. It's political division. Even now, when you read some literature, some people who should be responsible, but those who don't support the government, you'll find them cheering. But now look, the children who have been killed in Kasese, are they the president's children?
No.
Are they children of ministers?
No.
I don't think ministers' children study from such schools. So when you jubilate on the death of innocent kids, and you know everything, because they think such things now will make the government unpopular. But really, must innocents, like these little kids I saw, be killed so that the government can collapse?
No, they shouldn't. A very sad situation there in Kasese, but my time is fast spent, sir. We've got to close the show here. Thank you for coming to speak to us about the ADF. This has been the week's checkpoint. We send our condolences to the people of Kasese who lost their children, their relatives, and the entire nation who have lost fellow nationals and actually grieving. Otherwise, the community has got to be very vigilant to fight terrorism. The ADF activities in Kasese, specifically in Impondwe, were a terrorist attack, and We do hope that the community will be vigilant to deal with some of these things, like Major Retired David Drusa has just been saying here. Thank you very much.